Tell me about some spiritual or metaphysical experiences.
Oh, so those mystical experiences? Oh, I've had like, well, the best way I can describe those experiences is how similar they are to psychedelic trips. So like, if you're taking like NMDMT, or again, DMT is a little different from 5-MeO-DMT. So the most of the experiences are closer to my NMDMT experience, which I only took once. It's you just seeing like fractals of things, like, you know, going in and out of each other, and just like, you know, going to the wormhole and just your usual psychedelic stuff. You know, if you pull out one of those psychedelic videos, like the infinite spiral, things like that, that's very common when you're still going through the process, very, very common. But the 5-MeO-DMT is the one that gives you a glimpse of non-duality right away. That isn't really an experience per se. So what happens during a 5-MeO-DMT trip is that you get a glimpse of your true nature, of infinite, vast infinite space. But then it's always laced with a lot of your bullshit too. It's always laced with a lot of your conditionings. So that's why you get the trippy stuff like filtered on top of the vast infinite space, right? So when I took the 5-MeO-DMT, I actually did two hits. The first hit, I was like spiraling my own mind. I was perceiving like infinity. I realized that wasn't it. So I took another hit. And then that was dissolved, and I glimpsed into the emptiness of true nature. So again, my direct experience right now is the emptiness of true nature without the visuals. So like during the unfoldments, when my stuff is coming out, when the lenses of perception is getting dissolved, I experience very similar stuff as well. Yeah. Just like, you know, having orgies with the whole universe, like having sex with like different entities. I had an experience where like, I was like pretty much wide awake, but I was in a really like, I was awake, I wasn't sleeping, but then because I was on earth going through like a kundalini unfoldment, so like my state of consciousness was like altered, I literally saw midgets appearing like in my room, like trying to suck my like it was like right there, it was like deformed midgets, it's like just like a bunch of deformed midgets, and it came back like 3 or 4 times, like there's just like little midgets like right in front of me trying to suck my and then I was like, okay, that's something I need to look at. Why is my why is that being projected onto in my consciousness right now? Yeah, but like I say, you know, sex was like one of the biggest conditionings that I needed to dissolve. So maybe that's probably why. So like a lot of those visions are like sexual, very sexual, and a lot of visions of like gods and like, you know, like previous, like I remember my, in one of my retreats, I experienced something like going back in time, like just like becoming younger and younger until like before I was born, and then there were like dinosaurs and like just the whole shebang, like the birth of the universe, all that stuff. Yeah, so I experienced like pretty much everything you can read about in spirituality, and like experiences that I've experienced them all, and then now they're just like, oh, that was cool, but where are they now? Like to me, this right here, what I'm experiencing right now, which is what everyone has experienced if they remove the like the center, it's in a sense way more profound, but at the same time way simpler than anything you can experience on like meditation or psychedelics. So it's almost like it's the merging of something that's like so divine is ordinary, and the two are one. You know, if you can't perceive God in like a piece of shit, then you haven't realized God, right? You can't make any distinction between like this is God or this is not God, this is truth, this is not truth, right? It's the duality. If you make that, you can't make a distinction between this kind of mystical experiences closer to the source than like other kind of mystical experiences, because everything is source. When everything is source, there is no source in a sense. Yeah, so that's why I like to use this phrase: when you truly realize God, God disappears. When you truly realize the self disappears. When you truly have an insight, you consume it. It's like eating food. You know, when you eat a food, the reason why it disappears is because it is embodied into your physical form so completely that it disappeared. So if you're still perceiving God, then there's still a center, in a sense. Because most people who talk about God realization, they still have a center that's perceiving God consciousness that's over there. And they don't theorize about it or just attach their egos to it. But then when you truly realize God, when you are perceiving the Godhead as the Godhead, instead of perceiving the Godhead from still from the center of the separate self, then God ceases to become even a thing. Yeah, so that's when somebody asked the Buddha what he was after his awakening. He's like, hey man, what are you? And he was like, I'm neither man nor God. I'm awake. So he's like trying to tell you that, you know, what God and man are just, well, they're just concepts in a way, right? But then again, it depends on who I talk to. If I talk to somebody who's like really into God, wait, I use the word God. I have a friend who is like Christian, and then I have no problem with using the word God to describe the natural state, right? If I talk to a neuroscientist, I'll just go to the brain, right? If I talk to a non-dualist, I'll be like, yeah, there is no brain. This is just what it is. Yeah. So it's all of it. Yeah. It's all of it and none of it.
For people struggling with addictions such as sexual addiction, would you recommend meditation?
Meditation is really, it depends on how deep you go with meditation, really. Like if you in the middle of the path, sometimes like when the condition has come up, you can actually make it more horny. Yeah. I mean, so meditation is very tricky because when you get to the deep end of meditation, it's like, sometimes you can seem even more egoistical because number one, you're more aware of the ego, so you can feel like more contractions because now you're aware of it. Before, you're not aware of it. So you can become even more aware of your sexual drives. You can, you know, experience those things even more like intensively. And then we have any kind of insights into like no self, just even just a little bit. Sometimes you use that as like an anchor for spiritual bypassing. It's like, oh, there's no self anyway. Let me just go fuck around and cheat on my girlfriend. And like, you know, that can happen. So like, yeah, like I said, it depends, man. Like it really depends. Meditation really can go both ways if you go down to the deep end of it unless you finish the job. So that's why, you know, like going through the spiritual process is very similar to like going through a mental breakdown, because you're losing the mind, you're losing at least the ego mind or the solidity of the mind, right? So like that process of dissolution, a lot of the reports of people going through mystical experiences and dark nights, it's very similar to like bipolar disorder or like schizophrenia. Like I thought I was going crazy for so many times, like, you know, on the path, but then it's like, yeah, it's just like you just gotta get through it because you're dying. You're dying.
Yeah. When you look at a mental disorder through a spiritual lens, does that then give you the impression that they're misunderstood?
Sometimes I think, yeah, like sometimes, you know, like, okay, so what is schizophrenia? Schizophrenia is pretty much your ego gone amok. So like you hear voices in your head, you think it's real. You see images in your head, you think it's real. You can't distinguish between like reality and the mind, right? So, but in the natural state, in the awakened state, you cease to make that distinction too. But you're totally functioning, like you're functioning even more normally than before. But then you realize that the what's in your mind and what's outside the mind, there's no distinction between inside and outside, self and others. And in a way, it's kind of like, I don't want to say it's kind of like being schizophrenic, but you know, we just even just seeing a person on the street talking to themselves, you're like, okay, not even just everybody talks to themselves, right? Somehow we believe the voice in our head to be real, right? So even that, it's a very mild form of schizophrenic, right? So then a schizophrenic person who is, you know, officially diagnosed or clinically diagnosed is just a more intense version of that. So with realization, you kind of see through how there is no distinction between the voice in your head and the voice outside. So you erase the duality between what's real and what's not real. In schizophrenics, that there is still such, like if you want to classify something as being schizophrenic, you're still making a distinction between what's real and what's not real. You know what I'm saying? Like if you have this person is schizophrenic because he can't tell the difference between reality and his own mind, right?
Why are we at least seemingly detached from the natural state of mind or consciousness?
Because of conditioning. Like we talk about like traumas, right? Like, you know, all those traumas are manifested in, you know, the solidities in the body mind. That's what's separating us from like the unity of all things. So people talk about traumas, they're like, oh, something that happened to you when you're a kid, like you lost your job, your girlfriend broke up with you, you got abused, lots of trauma. Sure, those are traumas. But just the fact that you were giving birth is already traumatic, the trauma of the existence. So when I talk about the dissolving the standard, like the seer, the thinker, the doer, the hearer, right? Even the solidity in the head is a result of trauma. It's a trauma of separation, a trauma of identity. Right. So even just something as thought of as having a perceiver inside your head that's congealed, just congealed sensations that's trying to take credit for true nature. Even that's trauma, because we're born and then our mothers give us a name. And that moment is already conditioning. It's already a sense of separation there. So over time, we have like hundreds and thousands of things that are like just piled up on our natural state due to conditions like that. That's just one example. You know, you go to school and then you have a certain role you play. Like when you go out into society, you have a job. And all those conditionings are manifesting themselves as physical solidities somewhere in the head or in the body. For most people, it's in the head, because that's where most of our identification with the self is. It is with the perceiver.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.